I'll call the meeting to order. It's 6:30. We're here tonight as a joint meeting with the Finance Committee to talk about the warrant articles. It's our first item on the agenda, special to be presented at a special town meeting on December 1st at 7:30, I think. Yeah, at that time, so. We'll go through these for, I guess, recommendations from Finance Committee and us. And Select Board will make final approval next Monday, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Brian, is that right?
That is correct.
Okay, Brian, are you gonna?
I can take this to this chart.
Okay.
Want me to read the warrant article or?
Go through them and then, yeah.
One by one?
Except the long ones, maybe.
Except the long ones. We'll accept that written.
Oh, there he is.
When we get to it.
Okay.
He's calling his stockbroker.
You know what it is?
Yeah, I'm selling out.
So did New Hampshire go? Did New Hampshire finally settle?
I bought a nice piece of Princeton over Charles.
That's where I'm going.
You gotta love the poutine.
I've been there, yeah.
I've been there. I love it.
It was funny, they're gonna build a wall.
I already opened the meeting for you, so.
Good.
Turned it over to Brian.
I'm like, boy, we got.
And Brian's gonna read and we're gonna talk.
Yeah.
All right.
Go, Article 1. To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $5,400 from fiscal year 2016 free cash to pay the unanticipated school transportation expenses of a student without a permanent residence temporarily residing in the town or take any other action relative thereto.
Explanation.
Explanation. So, under the, you want the technical explanation? Under the.
No, I want it. So I can understand.
When there is a homeless student that moves into the district, the district that he moves into is required to pay half of the transportation cost for that student. In this case, the student who moves into Whately is attending Smith Volk. So we split the transportation cost with Smith Volk. So $30 a day, $180 per year. That's the cost.
So this is for a year?
Yep, this would be.
So, Brian, just as an update here, I think there's some packets without page one.
Yeah, I don't have.
It's on the other side of the agenda.
Well.
You're right.
Okay.
Okay?
Good to go.
That's good.
Environmentally friendly.
That makes sense.
So our hands are tied. There's nothing we can do about it.
$108 times 180.
$30 times 180 days.
They said 100, okay.
There's no advantage. Sunderland has two students.
Explain to your other one here too, you got this one.
Doesn't help us.
So you're saying actually that it's not 30, the total cost of transportation is $60 a day for an hour and a half of work.
That's a good deal.
Where's Uber?
What?
Uber.
Uber won't come to Whately.
That's a good deal.
Maybe somebody should join.
All right.
All right. Carry on.
Do we want to have? To expedite this, why don't we vote after each one of these? Do the Finance Committee first, and then our decision will be known and passed over to the Select Board, and they have till when? Next Monday?
Next Monday, but.
Next Monday. And in between, why don't we allow for public comment? If there is any public comment regarding the article itself, and that's the time that the public should jump in, if you want to. And then we'll take the vote.
Just a cautionary tale that if we have a lot of dialogue on every question, it could be a late night, so we want to limit it somewhat.
Right, but I'm saying that that's the time for the comment versus, you know, we have a circular motion here or a conversation.
Yeah.
So we have the first. Do I have?
I make a motion, we approve the transfer of $5,400. For the transportation expense.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
FinCom?
What if there's a day off?
I don't know.
You mean if the kid's sick?
Kid's sick or is it a day off?
I
I think it's a fixed cost.
School's canceled, snow or?
Oh, they still have to make up the time. I mean, 180 days, doesn't, you know, if it's December or June.
Next.
Okay. So we're good. We voted on, did we get a number? So it's.
Do we want to expedite? I'll make a motion that we accept that one.
Yeah, let's, I'll second.
Okay.
Okay, number two, number whatever. Next.
To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $10 from fiscal year 2016 free cash to account assessor's expenses to pay unpaid bills owed to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Franklin Registry of Deeds for prior fiscal year, take any other action relative thereto. Explanation, there is a $10 copy invoice that was provided by the Board of Assessors from past fiscal year.
I make a motion, we move to transfer the money.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Done.
Public comment.
Silly use of time.
Yeah, what a silly use of time.
I'd like to comment that we changed the term free cash to excess tax revenues so the people at home.
Not at this time.
So the people at home know what we're talking about.
It's not the same thing.
What, the free cash term?
Term.
It's not the same.
Or explain what it is.
If you want to define free cash, we can do that, but it is a legal term.
I understand.
That's used throughout the Commonwealth. And we've used it forever and ever. But your point, it's a good point, because I'm sure there are individuals that watch this.
Don't have a clue.
And they think free is, we found it, you know, which we didn't. This is an apolitical body, our town administrator should explain all terms.
Point.
We want the explanation now, or do you want another one?
Now, he's asked for it now.
Just
point of information.
So, at the end of the fiscal year, when there's excess money in the accounts, it is all rolled over into something called, an account called free cash. And that money is available after it is certified, usually gets certified October, November. And that is money from the prior year's budget that could have accumulated from a variety of sources. It could be state aid, tax relief. It's a combination of all of those sources of revenue.
Sound fiscal management on the part of department heads, any number of things.
It could have a better term, but it doesn't.
It doesn't. So and we can't control it.
Yep. That's
okay.
Called leftover.
Okay, right. Select board so on select the $10.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Next article. To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $40,000 from fiscal year 2016 free cash to pay for the engineering and design costs to connect the Whately Water Department's water distribution system to the Whately Water District's water distribution system, or take any other action relative thereto.
This will probably need a little explanation.
This probably will. I'll start, and we have folks from the Water Department and the Water District in attendance. Everybody knows the background about the Whately Water District and the Water Department. The systems come to within, a couple hundred yards of each other in the town center. And the Whately Water District is a small district, and it's becoming infeasible, impractical.
We have less and less water coming out of the ground.
I mean, this year particularly is terrible, but we've had water shortages most summers. And the cost of operating this little system is unfeasible. It's
unsustainable
in the long term. I mean, it's fine this year and next year probably, but.
So what are the engineering and design costs gonna do for us? We already know we have to combine them. Is $40,000 enough? Is this just a overview? I think the water department needs to speak for that. I mean, I get it's going to combine. I get that. But is $40,000 enough? Are we going to be
coming back here looking for more money?
This is the money for the design and engineering.
Okay.
That'll give
us. All they're going to do is look at it. And this is an overview.
And do some design work so we can get some realistic estimates of what it would cost to do the combining. but there needs to be a pump station in order to create the volume necessary to meet the demand and the fire chief's desire to have enough water.
This is just to get the design going.
Firefighting.
And is this enough?
Yes, there's been two estimates.
Okay.
Can I just ask, how many homes does this impact in this?
There's 42 connections in the water district, which includes the center school, town hall, post office, church, and the Whately Inn.
Library.
So what's that leave us with? 39 houses.
So is the product of the study going to be bid ready documents? You can be able to go to bids on this, or is there going to be?
I don't think so, no.
No, so there's going to be another design phase, product design phase, if you want to call it, to develop bid ready documents.
Right, and there's there'll be some permitting costs as well.
And what is the cost of that?
That's what we'll find out from this study.
This study will tell you that.
So there's no way to combine the two steps?
We have to decide on the scale of the project, like how big a pumping station, how much water you're going to try to move, what other infrastructure upgrade you might need. So you can't really scope it until you've done that analysis.
Sure. And is there a time frame for getting this part of the project done?
I think our hope is to get the report done so that we can come to the spring town meeting with a proposal for the combination.
Okay.
Are any homes at the point where water is an issue right now, not getting adequate supply, or?
We have adequate pressure, and now that I found the leak that we had a month ago, mm-hmm. our wells are keeping up. We are using our emergency backup well. I got temporary dispensation from the DEP to use a non-permitted well. Everyone still is in conservation mode, which is great because the ground is very dry.
Sure.
But everyone's got drinking water right now and water to flush the toilets.
Yeah. So is this meant to combine, not just fiscally, but combine the two systems together so you won't be shutting down that system, or you will be shutting
down? The intention is, end the water district, have it folded completely into the water department.
Not the water district, but the wells and everything else that you currently...
The amount of water that they pump is so insignificant compared to the amount of water the water department can put out. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah, it seems to me that, wasn't this looked at like 2 years ago when we had the issue with the water supply for the town hall sprinklers? Wasn't there some kind of engineering done back then?
There was no engineering done. We got a few bids. We got proposals for the engineering work from a couple of companies.
Yeah. It's basically the same thing, that you needed a pump station to pump the water up to the center of town.
Because of the height difference between the town's water tank and the center of town,
there's either put another tank up higher, yeah, further back, or
we need to boost the pressure. Yep. And it was looked at. We had a proposal for engineering back in 1990. That was when the conversation first got started.
I make a motion that we transfer the sum of $40,000 to pay for the engineering and design costs.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I'll make the same motion.
Second.
Aye.
All set. See if the town will to transfer the sum of $64,000 from fiscal year 2016 free cash to pay for a portion of the cost to purchase a secure storage vault for the town office building, or take any other action relative thereto. So the explanation, this, and Lynn Sibley's here, she can probably provide more detail than I can, but this would be for the installation of a storage vault in the town offices, behind the town clerk's, town treasurer's offices. Is there's no...
Where's it gonna go, Lynn?
Well,
you can see it out.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, it's easier to explain.
Going in where the wall's partitioned off now, or
yes.
Next to that. Yes.
How much of a portion is this?
That's half. We're hoping community preservation. Well, I mean, it needs to go to town meeting. It's been approved by CPA.
Is there any advantage to financing this versus free cash?
How's the free cash?
Good.
$590,900.
Yeah.
But if you take out $200,000 to offset taxes, $200,000 for stabilization, now you're down to $200,000. Just proposing.
One of the other.
Yeah, but that'll be resupplied, you know, with the new dollars coming in from the state. And when?
Which would be?
No, I'm not referring to CPA.
No, he's talking
when free cash is
free cash. How come CPA?
When the new free cash gets certified.
Which, yeah.
Next year.
Next year.
It just got done.
We just certified.
Right.
This is coming out of current free cash.
So
yes, fiscal year 2016 free cash.
Right. If I could just jump to something else real quick.
Yeah.
And talk about the cell tower easement revenue. So that's not included in free cash. That was Department of Revenue had us place that into an account reserved for appropriation. It's called receipts reserved for appropriation, and that is so it's for the sale of land received available for appropriation. That's a specific restricted fund that allows us to take money out of that fund for very specific purposes. And there's a laundry list of items. I can share the statute with you if you want after. And it almost acts as kind of a stabilization fund as such. You can only take out money for these specific stated purposes. And one of those could be for renovations to buildings.
Okay.
So it is an option if we wanted to take it out of that fund.
And what's that fund? It's true.
What's the amount?
Yeah.
The amount is $1.2 million. And we'll have discussion later about whether a chunk of that will come out for the payoff of the USDA loan.
You think we should have that? I mean, talking to everybody, that we should have that discussion separately.
Yeah, we've got sheets on it there, and we can discuss that later. But we shouldn't be going into it now.
Yeah,
right.
Except he's proposing you might be able to use the $400,000 of that instead of your free cash.
I'm saying you could pay for the vault either out of FY 2016 free cash, or you could pay for it out of the sale of land reserve for appropriation.
And that's just an account selection. That's not a logistical. That is just logistics. It's not. It's money is money that the town can have access to.
The money is money. One is more difficult purposes for which it could be spent.
It's very specific uses.
I get that. Okay. I get that.
But you'd also have to specify in the article where it's coming from.
Yeah.
Well, the other option I think somebody mentioned is to have it all come out of CPA funds.
I didn't request it all out of CPA because I felt that there were other requests coming into CPA that may need to be funded, and I didn't want to be greedy and try and use all of their historic preservation funds. So that's why I felt it was a little fairer, I guess, from a CPA standpoint anyways, to take a little from both locations, or take it from both locations. Yeah.
Are there any other comments regarding which bucket we take this money from?
Well, I think free cash is important, and not we just we've got a number at the top, but we don't know what else is coming out of that. I agree with what Paul is saying about we have to identify what bucket it's coming out of, but you go to a meeting, people are asked what bucket is it coming out of. Sure. So that's why I guess I don't know enough right now to really say. I think the safe thing would be to take it out of the restricted fund, but I don't know if that's the right thing or not.
What would it add to the cost if we did put it out to a loan over 2 years? It wouldn't be a big chunk of change to spread it out over 2 years.
Well, it wouldn't be a chunk of change, but I mean,
I would say that we do have the funds to pay the $64,000.
Right. I get that. I'm just
not $640,000. That's $64,000.
Because there are going to be other demands on our budget next year because of lagging revenue streams from different sources. So, if we've got it now, it's
when.
Just to complicate the whole discussion more, you also have the capital stabilization fund. So if you're concerned about depleting any of those, perhaps the capital stabilization might be an option as well.
How much do we have in that fund?
Capital, I think, is
I'm a little nervous about taking it out of free cash, given what we're already taking out of free cash. Squeezing that account too much. It seems like the restricted account might have more flexibility and maybe stabilization.
The other thing you can do is if we take it out of stabilization, when we go to balance, when we go to do the budget, by April we should have a pretty good handle on what we have left in free cash. We could always transfer $64,000 from free cash back into the stabilization account.
What's in stabilization right now?
170.
170?
No, that's capital. 175 in capital stabilization. I think it's 212 or something.
That's all?
Yes, because you took out $188,000 for the Mill River project. That will eventually be replenished.
But it's not there right
but
now.
But it's not there right now.
But that reserve fund is not the stabilization fund.
That's right.
That's a
separate fund. Like Tom's idea has some merit, then we could transfer funds at the Springtown meeting as needed.
As needed.
Sure.
So how do we move forward?
Let's move. I make a motion that we transfer the $64,000 from
capital stabilization.
Do I have a second?
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
I move the same.
Second.
Aye.
Aye.
Next article. To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $5,000 from fiscal year 2016 free cash to pay for the cost of electrical upgrades to the highway department garage or take any other action relative thereto. There was a special town meeting in March of 2016 and $15,000 were appropriated for this work. And I believe the estimate that was received at the time didn't in fact run the prevailing wage.
Or lights.
It did, in fact, earn prevailing wage. So when we went out to get estimates for the project this past month, they were above what was appropriated.
The prevailing wage more than doubled the labor of the original estimate.
So how many estimates is this based on?
We had two estimates.
But the prevailing wage, those estimates aren't going to change that dramatically.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
It is what it is.
So you're looking at $20,000 total.
The one, yeah, there's the one thing that I am researching a little bit was the three factors that were involved pretty much were, number one was to upgrade the lighting from its current fluorescent lights to current standards LED lights. That's one aspect of it. The second aspect was to deal with all of the outlets throughout the building and the electrical work that we, you know, have outlets, because none of it is ground fault protected. And there has been some instances, however very rare, where somebody will get a shock when you go plug, when you're standing on the wet ground. So that's the second aspect. The third aspect was, it was recommended that we replace the wiring in, since the built, that wiring was, is original from 1960 when the building was built. That's one aspect I'm looking at to see if we don't replace the wiring, how much I could possibly save, but I don't have that answer back from at the moment. But so at the moment,
how old is the wiring?
1960.
Why wouldn't you change it?
I'm just saying that's a possibility to try to save money. If we don't want to take that portion out of it, then I need the 5,000
cushion
that would then get everything done. But that would be the only thing that, as we've had people look at it, the people who've come in said, our building, the lighting in there is not bright enough. It does, if you were to have someone get hurt, for instance, they tripped or they walked into something because they said they couldn't see well enough, the lighting does not meet enough lumens in the building to be OSHA compliant.
Yeah, I think the long and short of this is that it needs to be done.
So disappointing
that it wasn't.
That'll finish
up front.
Yeah, that'll do it.
It wasn't done. That's a mistake by whoever, but at this point, you need it.
I'm going to make a motion to transfer the money, $5,000.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I so move.
Second.
Let me just add one editorial comment. I guess I would look again what Keith is bringing up, the third factor, replacing the wiring. There's a lot of homes that have older wiring that meets code. Meets code. If it meets code, I guess consider leaving it in. As you know, I did, and others have redone houses in the past year. I didn't take out all the wiring. The electrician that did the work was comfortable at using what was there. If that's the case, then I would say you can save money by doing that. If it meets code and they're willing to do it, fine. Okay.
All right.
Next. To see if the town will vote to authorize the Frontier Regional and Union School District to use the remaining $6,109.17 of the original $10,070, which was originally appropriated in Article 18 of the 2004 annual town meeting for the purpose of replacing the roof of the former East Whately Elementary School, to instead use the remaining funds for relocating the central office to the Frontier Regional Middle High School, or take any other action relative thereto. There's a request from the school district to repurpose these funds, which were originally for maintenance repairs to the roof of the Blue School, to help with the move to the central office move to Frontier Regional Middle High School. These funds are appropriated and they are in the custody of the school district.
So they already have it in their budget.
Yeah, correct.
Just authorizing them to transfer it.
Right.
Well, what's going to happen when it's empty?
The better question is leaving a building vacant.
Yeah, what's going to happen when the building's empty?
Well, it's supposed to be used for storage.
But have we gotten any clarity?
Who's going
to
maintain it?
There was a difference of opinion last time about what that's going to do to the insurance costs of the building.
There was a cost. They talked about
it.
They did talk about that. It was going to be a lot less than originally.
But there was a difference of opinion, as I recall, because what we had heard in the past was that the building was not going to be used by full-time staff or even part-time staff. It was going to be visited a couple times a day. Will an unoccupied building boost the insurance costs of that building so that it's just going to add a cost to the town that we don't see here? That's the more pressing question, I think.
I think they decided they said to go from the insurance
company. Yeah,
that's what I read. I didn't see it in writing. I didn't see anything that said that. And that goes completely counter to what we heard.
It might be in our minutes.
Were you at that meeting, John?
We talked about it, but there was nothing verifying.
There was.
I thought they said they talked to their insurance.
Well, but again, my question is, and we had talked to our insurance carrier when we were talking about Town Hall, and the cost to Town Hall, if it was unoccupied, was going to go up. So we're getting
two different opinions. And I just want to see something in writing.
So let's get it in writing.
And I hope they're right, but...
Yeah, well, that's what she said that at the last meeting, that the insurance had come... But there's nothing in black and white.
And, and again, it goes completely opposite to what we learned about Town Hall Emeritus.
What's the long-term prognosis for that building? Is there any talk about
it?
Plan for it, or because...
They want to use it for storage, was there?
Right.
But they own, that's got to be climate controlled.
Somebody's still going to maintain it.
Yeah, it's got to be climate controlled. There's storage records.
So they're still going to be looking for money to maintain it.
Yeah, the three towns are still, Frontier District, four towns are going to pay to maintain it.
But I think it also, when you deal with an insurance company, you got to be specific what you're asking. Is the building occupied? And I think our terminology was it was vacant. The building was vacant. Now, you could say it's unoccupied, or it's visited, or used. I mean, you got different terminologies, and you probably will get different answers.
I got to tell you, if someone's visiting that school from the high school once or twice a day, that's a colossal waste of time.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
Okay, well, I guess we
have to get it in writing.
Get it in writing.
In terms of the warrant article.
Yeah. Is there a motion to...
I make a motion we...
Except
let him accept article whatever. 610917.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Same. Second.
Yes.
So the yes.
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 Next article, to see if the town will vote to use $2,500 of the $3,530 remaining in account. Repairs to library roof for the purpose of making repairs to the kitchen and yes, White Dickinson Library, or take any other action relative thereto. This is a request from the library trustees. They have $3,500 left in their account that was for the repairs to the library roof and some other exterior repairs. And they have excess money, and they'd like to make some kitchen repairs.
I make a motion we vote to use the $2,500 in account for the making repairs of the kitchen and the library.
I second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Same.
Second.
Aye.
Mm-hmm.
Next article, to see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $5,035 from account water department cleaning and waterproofing storage tank to account water department operations to pay for expenses related to manganese management, or take any other action relative thereto. This is an amount that's left over from the project to waterproof the storage tank, and they'd like to move it to the operations account. They'll pay for the cost related to the manganese management.
So it's their money.
So make a motion to approve it.
And it's required.
All right. Okay.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Question?
Any questions from them?
Yeah, what's the status of the manganese filter or whatever's being done?
Still waiting on the DEP's approval of the plans for the pilot study.
Okay, so I move we accept this as well.
Yeah. Next.
All right. Yeah.
Second?
Yep.
To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $25,000 from Water Department retained earnings to account Water Department manganese management to pay for expenses related to manganese management, or take any other action relative thereto. This is moving $25,000 out of the retained earnings to pay for the engineering costs, engineering, permitting, bidding, design work for the manganese filtration. And also put it together the Clean Water Trust loan application.
I make a motion we approve to transfer $25,000 within the Water Department.
Before we second that, is there any comment or further discussion on this amount?
My only question is, what's that going to do to the balance of retained earnings?
It is on the end here somewhere.
Oh, it is?
It is going to, they started with 89,000 $781, so we'll leave them with $64,781.
All right, so, okay, thank you.
Is this transferring money to the same account, both of these articles?
No.
They're different.
From the district, you have to prove what they use, how they use their money, that's all.
Yeah, but it says, we're related to manganese management, and then this one says the same thing, related to manganese management, but you've got two different account numbers.
They are.
You've got a lot of accounts.
They are intentionally two different accounts, because there's a line item for manganese management in the operations budget as well.
Oh, okay.
Just accounting.
Okay, Ben, do we have a second on this?
Second.
All those in favor on the fin?
Aye.
Same, second.
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah.
Next article, to see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $804,925.53 from account. This is for the sale of land received available for appropriation to pay off the USDA Rural Housing Services loan, the town office building project, loan number 9702, or take any other action relative thereto. That is the payoff amount for
this building.
This building.
Any discussion?
I only have one question, is what will it do to what we owe? Will it reduce the tax rate, or are we gonna stay the same what we're paying? Know what I mean? Because now we're not gonna have a loan payment.
Technically, it should reduce it, because we are not, although we didn't make any payments on this building.
We made one payment.
Okay, so it's really, but that's already factored into our budget.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was $36,475 that was part of our debt.
But we have already paid it.
We paid one payment, and that reduced this.
So what were the payments gonna be per year?
$36,475.
Wasn't the original loan $810?
Yep.
We paid $36, and we still owe $804.
Probably with interest and anything else.
That's what banks make.
Elizabeth Warren.
Right, the first payment is all interest.
All interest.
All interest.
All right.
I make a motion, transfer the sum of $804,925.53 to pay this building off.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Same.
Second.
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah.
All right.
Paid. Okay, burn the mortgage.
Next article.
See at the end.
We should get a renter.
Hey.
Let's go.
We have a new brew house.
Let's go.
Okay, next.
This is actually a question for the Board of Selectmen, or the Select Board. I did receive an appraisal probably within the last 2 hours. And so the sum is not listed there. We have not entered into any negotiations, so I'm not sure how you want to proceed, if we want to make the appraisal amount known in a public meeting, or we want to wait until the 14th.
I think we should wait for the 14th.
Talk about it in executive session. Although that will not give the Finance Committee the opportunity to comment on it unless it wants to have a...
Why? The Finance Committee would be more than welcome to come to our executive session if you chose to.
Thank you.
Okay.
You?
Okay. On the 14th?
Okay. Yeah, next Monday.
Okay. So, any agreement on that?
I guess.
Three of us?
Yeah, to take it under consideration in executive session on the 14th.
Yes.
Okay. Is everybody familiar with what this parcel of land is on the Finance Committee?
No.
Okay.
Okay.
Refresh us.
Brian?
Sure. So, I don't remember when this was. Late this summer, there was a large tobacco barn fire adjacent to the elementary school. And that tobacco barn, well, what used to be the tobacco barn, was located on it's about an 8/10 of an acre parcel that's immediately adjacent to the Whately Elementary School. And we've had some discussions with the landowner to sell that property and make it part of the property that the Whately Elementary School sits on for a variety of potential uses. Could be for parking, could replant the screening further back into the field if we own that. There's potential possibly to explore solar on that property. So there's a number of other uses that that could be used for.
Thank you. 0.8 acre?
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, let's move on.
Next, I hope you'll save me from reading this whole thing.
Yeah, we will.
Whately Affordable Housing Trust, to see if the town will vote to accept the provisions of Mass General Law Chapter 44, 55C, and establish a trust known as the Whately Affordable Housing Trust, whose purposes shall be to provide for the preservation and creation of affordable housing in the town of Whately for the benefit of low and moderate income households, and further to amend the general bylaws of the town by inserting a new section, which I will have put in there to be entitled Whately Affordable Housing Trust Fund as follows, or take any other action relative thereto.
So there's no monetary?
No. And not with this article.
Right, it's just to establish a...
Right.
Not even a district, it's just a...
A formal entity.
Fund.
Okay, another letter in there.
Establish a trust.
Which you could put money into down the road.
Right.
Okay. Do we need to vote that?
Is the finance committee?
Yeah.
Probably not.
All right. I just have a concern. I've worked a couple times now with the housing committee that my impetus is that this should be directed towards senior housing, not low income housing. I think the bigger problem in this town is about 60% of our population is our seniors. They're going to be looking for housing. They're not going to be looking for individual Habitat for Humanity housing. They're going to be looking for some sort of multifamily type unit, condos, whatever. Sunderland's working on a 12 or 14 unit scenario. Conway's looking at 3 to 4 acres to put multiple units on, but all for senior housing. I just question if we couldn't modify this phrase so that it specifically refers to senior housing for land purchases, building purchases, or the construction of buildings.
So my question would be then on designating it for seniors regardless of income.
It'd make it income eligible for sure. Definitely income eligible. And that covers our low-income concept.
If we reach a certain percentage threshold, it covers us.
No, it begins to cover. It takes us from 0.3 to 0.4%.
What's the advantage of us doing this?
Well, by law, you're going to be required. If you're not already, you will be.
Right.
I
mean, by law,
we will be. I mean, there's a lot of gray area. Just looking at it quick.
Well, then get back to the purpose of the trust. Richard, do you want to explain why? That's what he's asking.
I can make a shot at it. You're correct that it is for restricted housing for persons and families of low and moderate income. I contacted the state. You can restrict housing to seniors, which is defined by the feds as 60. Or older. I think the issue, though, is you know this bylaw is a very generic kind of bylaw. It's specific for this town, but it's set up to be in operation for 10, 15, 20 years. And so the more you restrict the use of the funds, the more it becomes difficult later down the road to take care of new considerations. The trust itself is 5 members, one of whom is a select board member, and one of whom is a CPA member. Additionally, all monies expended by the fund in excess of $10,000 per year have to be approved by the select board. So I think there's a lot of elected and town control over how these funds are expended. If we need senior housing, the select board, the CPA will bring that to the fore. If that changes over time, you have the flexibility to then change the product mix over time. With reference to why do we need it, the fund would use CPA housing trust monies, so this wouldn't be new monies. It's simply monies that are piling up in the housing trust fund as we sit here this evening. which means that those monies then can be spent on affordable housing. If the trust fund, for whatever reason, receives additional money, it is easier for the trust to get it than for the municipal entity. So there could be a situation down the road where there is a grant available, the state has something available, some nonprofit organization wants to dedicate land of some sort. It's much easier to run it through the trust than it would be through the whole select board process. I think that responded to the questions.
Could you explain perhaps to the finance committee,
sure,
what happens to a building lot if the trust buys it and turns it over to Habitat for Humanity? Take us down the chain of ownership of the $100,000 building lot?
Well, the trust could purchase the lot from a private entity, a municipal entity, anything of that sort. The trust would then own the lot, but the money expended to purchase the lot means that that piece of land has to be reserved for persons and families of low and moderate income, which could, as I've said, include seniors. The trust would then dispose of that land in an appropriate way. 98% of the time it would be through what's called a request for proposal. The trust would simply send out an RFP to the development community, and the development community would then respond. In actuality, because we're a small town without a sewer, without a public sewer, you're not likely to get a 15 or 20 unit development unless you have a lot of energy and you have a decent and large staff dedicated to working with the feds, with the state, and with all the other funding agencies that you need to do that. So let's say you put it out for RFP, three developers respond. The trust would then take a look at those three proposals and select the one that came closest to what the town wanted. That proposal would then be accepted. The land would then be sold to that developer, and the developer would build on that property. There is no need that the property itself be tax exempt. It could be. It could be if the town wants to make that property tax exempt, it could. Or it could go in the tax rolls.
What price would we sell to the developer?
Yeah, it would be subject to negotiation. It would be subject to there's a program in development with municipalities called the but-for proposition. And I don't want to get into a lot of detail, but it mainly says, but for the municipal activity, how much would this development happen? If the development wouldn't happen, then the municipal entity has the right to sell the land at less than fair market value. So you would do, somebody would do, we'd have a consultant do an analysis. The analysis would say, what does the developer need as a profit? What is the cost of the loan? What is the cost of materials? What's the cost of labor? What's insurance? Soft costs, hard costs. At the end, out comes whatever money is left over, and that would be the price of the land.
So it could be zero?
It could be zero, yeah. It could be zero. Habitat for Humanity, which is one of many a small number of developers, they tend to go for a dollar, something of that sort. But there's no requirement to sell it at that low price. If that piece of land has three people who are proposing, two want, zero, and one is willing to provide $3,000, then the housing trust would probably go with the $3,000. It could be zero. It could be anything less than the fair market.
So the trust has that final say?
The trust would have the say, and the whole issue here is that you have to be able to be nimble to purchase property on the private
and that's
market.
What we discussed last year.
Yes.
We did that, which was right. Great. We said that's great. Mm-hmm. And now I guess we're coming into, now we can buy the property, we can be nimble, but how do we dispose of it, or how do we use the property?
Well, remember, activities in excess of $10,000 have to, $5,000 per activity, $10,000 per year, have to be approved by the select board. And the select board is the elected entity that has, if you will, day-to-day control over the trust. One select board member is on the trust, one CPA person. So two-fifths of the trust board, if you will, have these other, I don't want to say allegiances, but responsibilities that they bring to the board. They bring that expertise. They bring that insight.
So it would be the select board that determines the project that goes on that land? Because you said that
yes,
the project
actually
was determined by the town.
Well, the let's go back. The trust would say, we want to purchase this piece of property. It's in excess of 10 grand. The reason for the 5 grand per project and 10 grand per year is that the trust wants to do a little due diligence before it comes to the select board and says, this is something we want to do. So we have to know something. So the trust taking a look at a piece of land, spends some money on Title V and all of that kind of thing. Goes to the select board, says, we want to buy this piece of property. The select board is going to ask, what are you going to do with it? We want to put it out to an RFP for affordable housing. Now, if the select board wants to, at that time, they can say, that's fine, but we want to see the design and we want to have a final approval on whichever developer gets selected. And if that's their condition of approval, that's their condition of approval. So again, this is a long-term proposition. It's not just something to be done, you know, for 3 years and then quit. And so what's built into it is as much checks and balances as the select board and the CPA want to have.
So we're going to use CPA money.
Yes.
To buy land.
Yes.
To sell to you for a dollar so you can buy the house or whatever, and you make all the money. So we're going to use taxpayers' money.
There's not going to be any money. Because remember,
no. Then why would they build them?
Remember, the point I made is that, let's say,
I know that, but you're using taxpayer money to give land away.
Not really. We're using taxpayer money to subsidize a development, but for the use of taxpayer money, it would not happen. So it's like if I say to you, I've got a piece of property. It's going to cost you 150 grand to develop. I'm going to sell to you for 100 grand. That's 250. And by the way, I'm restricting the sale of this property to 210,000 because that's what the feds tell me I have to restrict it to. So I'm saying to you, are you willing to spend 250,000 to make 210? And the answer, of course, is no, you're not.
No.
So you're going to walk. So I say, wait, before you leave, come back. Instead of making you pay 250, I want you to have a reasonable return on your investment. The market says housing developers these days get, I don't know what it is, but somewhere between 10 and 15% maybe. So if you're going to get 210, and I make sure that the property costs you 85% of 210, you're a happy guy. The alternative, there is an alternative. The alternative is the town itself can build and take the developer's risk. This is all about risk and reward. The town certainly can do this. It can buy land, it can hire contractors, it can find people.
The town is buying the land with the taxpayers' money.
The town is buying the land with the taxpayers' money that has already been voted in. These are not new taxes. This is housing money that is sitting in the bank right now. There's about 100 grand. It's been saved up for how long? About
8 years.
So every year, CPA money comes into the town, and 10% of it has to be spent out. That's just what it has to do.
Otherwise, it just is never going to be used.
Right. And so your point is well taken, but as a private developer, you're going to demand a profit of some sort. You're not going to do it because you're a nice guy. And so that profit, it pays for your time, your effort, and your risk. And it's a proposition that has made sense, I don't know, for ever since the first Housing Act of 1947.
I would also argue that affordable housing is state law.
Yeah.
I understand the state law, but state law and practicality is like here.
But Bobby, that means you're saying that it's okay to
I'm not saying it's okay. I'm just saying it's practicality.
Well, but then we should do the right thing.
Why don't we just build a state apartment?
For seniors.
I don't want to be developers.
You don't want to take that risk.
In the end result, though, if something is built, say Mr. Developer comes in and he builds a single family that's restricted, but he owns it, how does that help the town's quota? Is it still considered affordable housing?
He would sell, well, he could sell it or he could own it, but the issue is it's what's called enforceably restricted. So let's say I'm the developer and I want to sell to a low and moderate income person, and I sell to Joe here. Joe has to fit certain tests that he has, you know, family size, family income, et cetera, et cetera. Then on his deed is a deed rider that when he goes to sell that property, he cannot sell it for an amount above what he paid for it, taking into consideration CPI and all that kind of thing. Now, if he does want to sell it above, there's all kinds of, we're getting into the weeds here. But in short, it is restricted in perpetuity.
So to John's question, though, it would help satisfy our quota for low-income housing.
Oh, absolutely.
Regardless of who owned the property.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, another point is, you know, when I did our development layout, I looked at the subdivision bylaws and looked at the cluster development portion to try to do something like that within the development. And one big issue is what they call nitrogen loading for multiple units, and especially in sandy soil. There's probably not a lot of sites in Whately that either are not sandy or rocky and big enough to try to do any kind of a multiple unit build out. So I'm not sure how beneficial this is gonna be in the short or long run.
Well, I think just to jump in from the finance committee standpoint, even though there are no dollars and cents that we're talking about specifically, going downstream, I think for us to get us to feel like this is good for the town, I think we have to know, and I think you guys should have to know, what the state requirements are around this affordable. So what do we need to do to say, okay, we meet those requirements?
Isn't it 10%?
Yeah, I'd love to have the town meet the requirements. We have two affordable units today, Spike's House.
Yeah,
three.
We're supposed to have 10%. And I don't know exactly how many units there
are.
That
would be about 60. 600 okay. Something dwellings.
Well, yeah. That's right. Single family
is worth a lot more than we got.
It's just units.
Okay. So that's never going to happen. And it's obvious that the state is never going to come down
and enforce
anything like that.
Well, so a developer could come to town and make a decision to come and develop a 40B development and force down the town's throat a project that they want, and we wouldn't have control of that project.
Yes, we would.
If we aren't making efforts to meet 40B, we would not.
We can enforce it through the building commissioner or building, because we do not have sewer. We would have to be on a septic system.
The developer would have to worry about that, but the developer could still build whatever they wanted to.
Well, that's what I just said. It's impossible. Units because of the DDP nitrogen.
The developer would have to put in a sewer plant.
Right, they would have to come up
with a sewer plant.
Let's move on.
We
don't even have, the finance committee has nothing to do with this.
I guess I just have one more question because I do want to move on. But this whole conversation started, and I don't know whether I agree with it or not, but Dan, you had recommended that we at least have it isolated for strictly senior housing, and I'm wondering why.
Well, not all of it, just if the purchase of land, purchase of a building, or the construction of a building.
But why?
Because that's where our big money's going. The rest, if they want to help low-income people with their house or a septic system
I ask the question again, what if it's low-income, it's low-income, what does it matter if the person's 75 or 25?
Because I think the biggest problem this town faces is not this 40B threat, it's the 60% of our aging population that has no place to go except they'll go to Sunderland and Conway and perhaps Deerfield.
But I would just food for thought, that another problem this town has is encouraging young families to move to the town. And right now, we don't have young families.
We have more growth than we can handle right now.
We don't have young families moving to this town.
We have tons of growth.
All right.
Dan.
I don't think we can settle this here.
Young families aren't moving to Whately.
I didn't say anything about young families.
That's my point, though. We need to be encouraging.
John.
What?
I don't think we're going to, I think the issue before us is to set up this trust.
Right.
That's it.
Yeah. So, and that's you three.
That's
you
us guys. And I think this is a good start to moving towards what we have to do to obey the law. Lynn?
So the trust is only for affordable housing, correct? Right. So you have to meet income eligibilities for that.
Right.
So many of our seniors, although we do have a group of seniors that probably would meet those rich, there are another whole group of seniors that may still have a housing issue that won't meet those income guidelines either. So maybe there's two separate issues.
Well,
and maybe we need to think about senior housing, but in a different way.
What I heard from Richard is that the select board would have the flexibility to designate and prioritize seniors
on a case-by-case basis.
Income
but
guidelines.
They have to be income eligible.
Right, right, exactly.
Right.
And they have to want to buy a house.
Well, exactly.
Well, yeah.
What senior wants to move into another house?
Right.
They're looking for multi.
Because it can't be rented, correct, Richard? The senior cannot rent the property. They have to own it.
They could. If their income.
The developer keeps it.
If
right.
Their income.
So it would be on a case by case basis. So
this doesn't bind us either way.
That's the point.
Okay. I would move that.
I'm good.
We need a recommendation.
No, they don't have it. No.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Well, fine with me. Yeah.
Okay.
Done.
We're done. Next.
All right.
Next, we'll stay in the same category. To see if the town will vote. This is the community preservation fund transfers. See if the town will vote pursuant to General Law Chapter 44B to appropriate and transfer the sum of $100,000 from the Community Preservation Fund Community Housing Reserve to the Whately Affordable Housing Trust, if and as established by article of this town meeting dated December 1st, 2016, and take any other action relative thereto. Said transfer is subject to and contingent upon the execution of a grant agreement between the Town of Whately and the Whately Affordable Housing Trust. This has been approved by the CPC.
So if at town meeting on the 1st, we do establish the Whately Land Trust.
Yep.
Then you're gonna give them. You're gonna transfer the $100,000 to them. If for some reason it doesn't get approved, then this article
to the meeting. Will be scheduled for a table.
Right.
But this is a separate vote. The
yes.
prior vote is to create.
Create it, and then this is
trust.
To fund, give them money,
and then we just gloss over it on town meeting floor.
Yeah. Okay.
Well,
I guess that's
okay.
Same thing.
Do we have a motion?
I make a motion that we transfer the $100,000 if the Affordable Housing Trust Fund is established.
I'll second it.
Second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Same.
Second.
Aye.
Next, to see if the town will vote pursuant to General Law Chapter 44B to appropriate and transfer from the Community Preservation Fund Historic Resources Reserve the sum of $15,000 and from the budgeted reserve the sum of $49,000 for a total of $64,000 to pay for the other portion of the storage vault.
What is this?
This is the other half of the vault. She wants to get the money from CPA.
Oh, from CPA.
Yeah. It's coming out of two different accounts.
No, we got it from a different account.
Right. Free cash.
We approved the other one.
It's an expensive vault.
Right, yeah.
God, I'll say.
I make a motion to appropriate and transfer from CPF the sum of 15 from the budgeted reserve to sum of 49 for a total of 64,000 to pay for the vault.
I second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Second?
Second.
Aye.
Next, to see if the town will vote pursuant to General Law 44B to appropriate and transfer from the Community Preservation Fund Open Space Reserve the sum of $6,500 to pay the town match portion for the joint purchase of an APR on 6.75 acres on Christian Lane owned by Carolyn C. Pam and Timothy and Wilcox. We'll take any other action relative there too.
Where's that?
There's a map here.
Is that on the, but is it on the, I can't tell from this map, is it on the east side or the west side of Wampanoag?
Right next to me, right next to me.
Right next to you?
Next to me, behind me, yeah.
And how many acres?
Oh, so four Harolds, that little piece.
Is there access to it right now?
Yes.
There's frontage.
So Fred, are you all right with this?
6.75 acres.
Mark is here and have questions to answer.
No, you've been very patient.
Margaret, my only question, and I'm sure I'm going to be real popular when I ask this. We do a lot of APRs, and I get land preservation, but at some point, are we going to APR ourselves out of any potential growth for this town down the road?
10,000 acres.
I think that's unlikely. I think there's a lot of landowners who want to preserve their options of what they're going to do with their.
But are they, is that developable land? I mean, there's a difference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is.
Well.
I mean, are people retaining ownership of developable land that they're not putting in APR? Is that your question?
Yeah, I just want to make sure that we're not doing this ad nauseam so that all of a sudden we turn around and say, geez, we can't grow. We can't stomach any more tax increases, so what do we do with rising costs?
Our percentage of preserved farmland is pretty low relative to towns around us and other towns, you know, that have the resource in agricultural land that we do. So I would say no. That's my opinion.
But that's 50% of the town essentially, so that's East Whately town.
Right, but relative to Hadley and Deerfield, I mean, I would have to have the numbers in front of me to know for sure. But relative to many of the towns around us, we have preserved less of our agricultural land. And the towns around us that also have those big agricultural land base.
Ron?
It's kind of a double standard there, what you're stating, because when we passed, or the town passed the residential B or something, where development beyond 400 feet from an existing road, you had to increase the lot size by twice. It basically took away a lot of developable land.
Expense more kind of development, I guess I'm covered with that.
Housing.
Single-family houses.
So let me ask a question to whoever knows the answer. What's the difference in revenues between a residential lot versus equally, I don't know, an agricultural? I mean, residential lots require services.
Residential lots cost more in services than they provide in revenue to towns.
Right, right.
And agricultural land pays more in taxes than they provide.
So if we were concerned about revenues, we would want more agricultural land, less residential.
But the variance.
Just for that alone.
But the variance on that diminishes as the house gets larger. I mean, the larger the house, the higher taxes they're paying.
Right, but overall, agricultural land, and that study has been repeated in town after town after town, including in Deerfield, not very long ago at all.
I get that, but.
You're talking about land with a house on it.
If you build a large house.
Land with a house on it.
And you're going to pay $5,000 in taxes. I'm just saying, there's a difference between $2,000 and $5,000.
Yeah.
Let's just be clear.
I think it has to do in part with the future of the town that we want, and whether we want to maintain an agricultural land base and an agricultural economy.
And if you have three kids pumping through school at $5,000 taxes and $39,000 costs, the land certainly comes out better per year.
There are a number of ways to look at it. I mean, the large house, the kids might go to private school.
Right, but Jonathan, you can't dial that in.
I get that.
We're only going to allow large houses for kids who send their families, send their kids to private school.
I get that.
It'll be on the warrant.
I'm encouraging.
Sign here.
I'm just encouraging.
You can't move the tone unless your kids.
Conversation needs to happen.
All right. I'm sorry I brought it up.
Don't forget the corn.
I bet you are.
Yeah.
What the votes for the current article?
Okay.
I make a motion, we.
Yeah. I didn't even know where it went.
It's article double asterisk.
We approved the community preservation fund, $6,500 for the APR.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Same.
Aye. Home stretch.
Okay.
Yep. Two authorizations to dispose of surplus property. See if the town will vote to authorize the select board to sell, donate, or otherwise dispose of the 1975 International Fire Truck as surplus property.
Good.
There too.
I make a motion that donate, otherwise dispose of the international fire truck.
It's up to the selectmen what happens to it.
Yeah.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Same.
Fine.
Same thing, 2001 safe trailer.
I could buy that.
What is a safe trailer?
To Canada, you can take it with you.
They bring it to the school and they show kids.
Hook it to the fire truck.
Fire education trailer. There's a, we have a.
I'll drive. I make a motion, we approve the disposal of the 2001 safe trailer.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Us two.
All right, you're all set?
Brings us to the signing conclusion.
Okay.
Now we're gonna do the other piece of this agenda? Is there more?
Brian made us.
Oh, God, Brian.
Budget process.
Right.
Mercy.
Touch briefly, while everybody's in the same room, I'm.
Yeah, so we, the upcoming budget process, it looks like budgets will be in, Brian said, by the 15th of January, thereabouts. So, you know, if you work back from town meeting, that gives us, and if we meet twice a month as we have been meeting in the past, that gives us, you know, somewhere around a half dozen meetings to iron the whole thing out. So if we can kick the first one off prior to January, prior to the February meeting, so like third week in January, we could have the first meeting. And we may not have all the budgets in, but the few that we have will get us going, and we can establish how we want to move past that and other issues that we have. Because we really need a budget to get together as a finance committee to either to discuss the budgets or other issues that pertain to how we move. Okay?
So you would start the process either Martin Luther King week or the week after Martin Luther King?
Yeah. So what do you guys think?
You're the chairman.
Brian, did you have a... I thought I'd be democratic about this. Doesn't matter, you want to, I can just tell you to. I can go Trump on.
I have a question about the kid from Fisk Bulk. Do we, we're transporting, do we pay the tuition?
No. The tuition is paid by the district, the town from which the student moved from.
Okay.
We got lucky on that one.
Yeah, that is lucky.
He's not old enough to drive by chance. Do we know that? Because I know they give like gas money. No, they give gas money.
I don't know. It's
not unusual. But we still have to provide transportation.
If we they have a vehicle, all we have to provide is gas. And they usually it's like... It's
100 bucks a week, right? Huh? 100 bucks a week?
Yeah, more for gas, yeah.
Might be cheaper.
It is cheaper. It's definitely cheaper.
I just wonder why, you know, we're not paying tuition.
I'm not quite sure. Let's get a date. Is Tuesdays or Thursdays better?
Tuesdays.
Select board still meeting on Tuesdays?
Mondays.
Mondays. Or when do you guys meet?
Mondays. Second and last Monday.
Tuesdays are good for me. Thursdays are not.
Tuesdays and Wednesdays are good for
you. Okay. I'm not good for Tuesday until about 7:30.
Can either one.
I'm in New Hampshire.
And Thursday's the same?
Thursday's the same.
Okay. That narrows that right down. Wednesdays.
I would prefer
Wednesdays?
Thursdays. Wednesday and Thursday. Wednesday, I could do.
Anybody can't
have a conflict with Wednesdays?
Okay.
At least once a month.
The what?
Yeah, at least once a month. There's a housing committee meeting on Wednesdays. First Wednesday.
What time?
6.
I can meet him.
We have our meetings at what, 7?
We can meet at 7.
Or 7.
We set our time, we better.
Want to meet at 7?
We can avoid the first Wednesday, then it's not a problem.
Yeah, so avoid the first Wednesday of the month.
Okay, well, that's fine. Then that's what we'll do. So it's the 18th. Let's make it the 25th, because we want to make sure that there's enough time for some of those budgets to get into Brian. So our first meeting will be the 25th of January. At 7,
Or would you rather meet at 6?
Earlier the better.
What am I hearing, 6?
Six.
6 a.m.? 6 p.m. We'll show up in the morning.
25th.
Okay. And then we'll...
Go from there.
We'll go from there.
Yeah.
Okay, we've got one, let's keep that one in stone and then forward.
So what's the intent of any type of joint meetings that might take place?
I would say this has been a great meeting. I mean, we're all on the same page. We make sure we have open lines of communication.
Okay. Yeah, it's a coordination.
I think what this did is it gave us a chance to get together, but it also, we're also voting independent of one another. And I think that maintains the purpose of having a committee and a board.
And we're hearing about possible objections anybody has before we get to a meeting.
Right.
To work it out.
Right. And Brian, it doesn't preclude us, if we wanted to, just so we don't have a meeting every night, from having a select board meeting after the joint meeting was over.
Yeah, absolutely.
But just to make your nights even longer.
Yeah, that's right. I'd rather them longer than,
Well, exactly.
Out.
And two of them.
Exactly.
Yeah, there you go. Okay.
But it really does foster communication, which I think is great.
Yeah. All right, any more business?
Yeah, what time's the executive session? I'm sorry.
Brian, just put on your agenda also that the capital planning will have to have their meeting prior to this.
Okay. Yep.
How do they decide which town the homeless person lives in? And who's responsible for transportation? Who's responsible for transportation?
Where's he living at? White Birch?
He's living in Whately.
But he's not homeless.
It's a child without a permanent home.
Okay. I just want, you could say, oh, go somewhere else if there are any money.
Keep it up.
All right. So there's a meeting, and then there's an executive session meeting?
Yeah, so you got to sit through our meeting.
Oh, okay. All right. One of those
deals.
Okay. Meeting starts at 6, right?
I believe.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're starting at 6 or 6:30? 6?
Right.
Okay. I thought 6:30, but
6:30.
There's 6.
6.
Oh, no,
that's what we posted. That's what you said the last meeting.
Okay.
We wanted to start at 6. You all agreed to it.
Okay.
At 6 and the 14th. Okay.
Next Monday, 14th.
All right. Okay. There being no further business, I move we adjourn.
Second.
Finance committee adjourn.
Finance committee.
Finance committee.
Move adjourn.
I second it.
All right.
Thank you.